In this video, I'm going to show you how to effectively set up Google Classroom for remote teaching. One of the biggest challenges of teaching remotely is the fact that communication between teachers and students is going to be more challenging when you're not in the same room together. For this reason, it's even more important that you have a well-organized, easy-to-understand digital classroom. When teaching remotely, I believe you should treat effectively setting up Google Classroom as your number one priority. The reason why is because you're going to use Google Classroom as your central hub where you're going to post announcements, assignments, materials, links to additional resources, and more. Students will even be able to hand in work through Google Classroom, and you'll be able to provide them with feedback on there as well. Students can also communicate with each other on Google Classroom, which is going to be important in order to maintain a sense of community. My name is Sam Kary, and this is my YouTube channel for the new EdTech Classroom. If you find the tips that I share in this video helpful, I'd appreciate it if you hit the like button, share it with other teachers that you know, and subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell to make sure you don't miss any of my weekly updates. If you're interested in learning about lots of different creative projects you can do with your students online, check out some of the other tutorials that I have on my channel. All right, let's jump right in and look at how to set up your Google Classroom for effective remote teaching. At the very first stage of setting up Google Classroom, you're going to be faced with an organizational question about how to set up your different classes. If you're an elementary school teacher, it probably makes sense just to have a single Google Classroom. But if you teach middle school or high school and teach different subjects, I'd recommend that you have a different classroom set up for each subject that you teach. So for example, if you teach math and science, you should have a Google Classroom for your math class and a separate Google Classroom for your science class. The reason for this is because as you add more material to your Google Classrooms, materials and assignments and announcements are going to be harder to find. Think of this phase of Google Classroom organization like a filing cabinet. You'll want one single drawer per subject, and then once you get into that subject, we're going to start to set up different file folders. Now, I'm in a situation that I imagine lots of other people are in. I teach different subjects, but I also repeat the same subject with different groups of students. In this case, I do think it's okay to just have one classroom set up for the subject that you teach. Though if you really want to keep everything separated, it's not difficult to duplicate assignments across different Google Classrooms, so it would be okay to subdivide them even more. Because I teach three separate classes and one club, you'll notice that on my Google Classroom home screen, I have four separate classrooms. In order to add a class, you'll go up to the Add button, click Create a Class, give your class a name, and click Create. You'll notice once you're inside of your Google Classroom that there are four tabs at the top: Stream, Classwork, People, and Grades. If you start posting without altering any of the settings on Google Classroom, it's going to put everything that you post on the class stream. As you can see, if you're posting announcements, material, assignments, discussion prompts, your stream is going to quickly fill up and become almost unusable for students. Because of this, I highly recommend that you change the settings for classwork on the stream to hide notifications. So now that you've ensured that your stream is solely for announcements, make sure that you're regularly posting announcements to the stream. I recommend that you post an announcement every morning so that when your students log into Google Classroom, they see a welcome message from you, as well as an agenda for the day for what you're expecting them to complete for your class. This would be a great place to post a Screencastify tutorial in which you could give an overview for the work that students are going to be completing. When you're teaching remotely, it's likely that you're going to have far more comments from students than you would in a typical classroom setting. If your students are like mine, they're going to be doing everything from asking questions to also just making some random comments. If you totally want to shut comments down, you could do that by going to the Settings tab and turning off student comments. But in the case of remote teaching, I do think it's important to allow students to ask questions and also have their peers answer questions for them. It'll be important to go over some basic guidelines for how to comment appropriately on Google Classroom. Typically, I just tell my students that if it's not academic related, it doesn't belong on Google Classroom. If you allow for comments, you're going to need to make sure that you're checking them. If a comment shows up that isn't really appropriate, you can easily delete it by going to the three dots next to a student's name and clicking delete. If I end up doing this, I'll usually email the student directly and just let them know about that and remind them of expectations. You do also have the option of muting particular students if a student is having difficulty commenting on Google Classroom in a productive and respectful manner. Now let's look at how to add students to your Google Classroom. In most cases, when students are actually in my class, I simply give them the class code, have them join the class, and then they're in. In the case of remote teaching, it probably makes more sense to add student emails and then invite students. If you choose to just invite students through email, it will send them an email, they'll click on a link, and just like that, they'll be logged in to your Google Classroom. Next, let's look at the Classwork tab. The Classwork tab is where you're going to be posting all of your assignments and resources for students. Similar to the first step when you had to think about how you wanted to label those bigger file cabinets, now you're going to want to think about how you're going to label your individual file folders. If you don't create different file folders or what are referred to as topics in Google Classroom, you're going to just end up with a big running stream of assignments that isn't going to be very well organized for students. To create different topics, you're going to go up to Create, scroll down to Topic, and then enter the name of the topic you want to create. Your topics might look different now for remote teaching. When I'm teaching in my regular classroom, for example, I have separate topics set up for classwork and homework. That's not really relevant in the case of remote teaching. Given that I usually need to direct my students to go to a particular topic to find work that I've posted, I'm going to be making a total shift to creating topics for each week that we are doing remote teaching. That way, my students will know exactly where to look for the assignments and resources for each week that we're doing online learning. It's really up to you how you choose to organize your file system, but what's most important is that you create one. Now let's look at how to create different types of assignments. You'll see under Create that you can post an assignment, a quiz assignment, a question, material, or you can reuse a post. By far the one I use the most is to create an assignment. You'll see that you can title the assignment and give it a description. It may be okay to be a little bit more sloppy with the descriptions when you're doing in-classroom teaching with Google Classroom, but given that your students are going to be relying on you for really clear instructions, I recommend that you spend some time outlining step-by-step what your students need to do for a particular assignment. Then you'll see that you have an option to add a file from your Google Drive, to add a link, to add a file from your computer, or to add a YouTube video. The benefit of using Google Drive as opposed to adding a file from your own computer is that it's going to give you the option to make a copy for each student. So if you create a worksheet or a graphic organizer that you want each student to complete on their own, it will make the most sense to click make a copy. I also frequently add links to my Google Classroom assignments. If, for example, you want your students to visit another website as part of the assignment, you can just copy the URL for that website and then add the link to the assignment. Next, you could add a file, and that would be a file that you have stored on your computer, not on Google Drive. And lastly, there's an option where you can search for and add a YouTube video that you're looking for. If you haven't already pre-created material using Google Docs, Google Slides, Google Drawings, etc., you can also do so by clicking on Create, and that will open up one of the document types, and you can create that in the moment. I pretty much never use this function because I always pre-create my materials and the assignment post on Google Classroom is the last step, but it may be something that works for you. Next, on the right-hand side, you'll see that there's a place where you can change the point value of the assignment as well as the due date. It's also really important that you actually pick the topic or file folder where you want this particular assignment to go. If you don't do that, it's actually going to show up on top of all the topics that you've created, and that might also lead to a more disorganized Google Classroom. If you click on the drop-down menu next to All Students, you'll see that all the names of the students that are enrolled in your Google Classroom show up. This function will allow you to push assignments out to a select group of students. So let's say that you've created some scaffolds for some students, like sentence frames to support them with writing an essay. You can select just those students to ensure that the whole class doesn't get that assignment. Next, you'll see that there's an option to create a quiz assignment on Google Classroom. If you do this, it's going to open a blank Google Forms for you. And Google Forms is a really easy way to set up a quick quiz or survey for your students. I'm not going to go over how to use Google Forms in this video, but I will in another tutorial. Another type of assignment that I recommend you use for remote teaching is to ask a question. If you ask a question, students will be able to post their response to that question. And then as long as you leave that setting on, they'll be able to respond to each other. This could be a great way to spark a quick conversation amongst students. Students could have an online debate, or you could even just post a question about how they're doing for the week and have students quickly respond. It's a really quick and easy way to have students be able to communicate with each other in an environment that you can easily monitor. Next, you'll see that there's an option to create material. The purpose of adding material would be if you want to add different resources that don't necessarily have due dates. The problem I've found with adding material that's separate from an assignment is that students won't necessarily click on the material, whereas they will click on the assignment and look at everything that I've posted within a single assignment. To me, there's really no reason to use material separate from an assignment unless you have something that's kind of completely unrelated to the assignment that you just want students to look at. But if you want students to respond in writing to a video that you've posted, I definitely recommend that you bundle that video with the assignment that you've posted and don't bother with posting it separately as material. Remember, the idea is that we want it to be really clean and organized. And to me, that means minimal places where students need to be clicking to access information. A useful function for both teachers and students is the embedded Google Calendar function. If you click on Calendar, you'll see that the assignment that you just created shows up in your Google Calendar. It works the same for students. So it's valuable to show them how to use the calendar function so that they're able to get a bigger picture of when all their different assignments are due. The class drive folder is also useful, particularly for remote teaching. Let's say you've created an assignment and made a copy for each student. Each copy is now going to show up in that class drive folder. This will allow you to hop onto a student's document at any point in the lesson. You might find that a student hasn't started and you might need to give them a call to remind them of the work that they need to do. Or you might have a comment on a student's work that's in progress that will help your student make sure that they're doing the work correctly. The Student Drive folder is a great way to be able to monitor your student's work and give them some formative feedback before the final assignment is handed in through Google Classroom. Let's look really quickly now at the student end to look at two different ways that students can turn in work. If you've made a copy of the document for each student, all they need to do is click turn in and that assignment will be turned in to you. If, however, a student had to make a copy of a file that they had view only access to, or if you want students to upload an assignment that they created in another program, which I do all the time, you're going to want to make sure that they understand how to upload that assignment into Google Classroom. To add the assignment, they'll first find the assignment, then click View Assignment. There you'll see that there's a button to add or create. Similar to the options given to a teacher, a student can either add a Google Drive folder or a link from their computer. If you start using a bunch of different tech programs and have students create things like videos and graphics or comics, you'll definitely want to make sure that students understand how to download the document off of the website that they've been working on and then re-upload it here as a file. Once that file has been uploaded, they can click turn in. One thing to note is that students can actually click turn in even if they haven't actually uploaded any assignment. The last important step for setting up your Google Classroom for effective remote teaching is the guardian summaries. The way a guardian summary works is that you can invite a parent of a student, and then the parent can choose how frequently they will get an email update about their student's progress on the work that they were assigned through Google Classroom. So let's say, for example, that you assign something on Friday and the student does not hand it in. The guardian summary will reflect that that student has a missing assignment. I stopped using guardian summaries during the regular school year because I don't always have my students turn in work through Google Classroom. So it was causing a lot of confusion because a lot of the times I was just posting on Google Classroom so that my students would have an extra copy of an assignment. If my student handed their assignment in by paper and not via Google Classroom, their parent was still getting an email saying that their work wasn't turned in. In the case of remote teaching, however, given the fact that I am going to be expecting students to turn in all of their work through Google Classroom, I now think it's a good idea to use Guardian Summaries. Of course, there are other features of Google Classroom, but I think those are the most important in terms of creating a well-organized, easy-to-understand hub where you can post announcements and assignments for your students to complete online. If you have any questions about Google Classroom or how I plan to use it for remote teaching, please ask in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching my video to the end. If you found the tips that I shared helpful, please share it with other teachers that you know, hit the like button, and subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell to make sure you don't miss any of my weekly updates. You can also check out some of the other tutorials I have on my channel by clicking on one of those two videos above. And if you're interested in downloading any of the resources that I've created and show on my videos, please visit my website at www.newedtechclassroom.com. Lastly, if you want to check me out on social media, my Twitter handle, Facebook page, and Pinterest account are all in the description below. Thanks so much and have a great week.